Tessaya de Vries. As this video could possibly be watched by people who haven't read the books, I'll split it up in a few parts. I'll first talk about her character, who she is and why she's important. After that, I'll give a spoiler warning for some of the books she appears in, as so I won't spoil anything about her that will not be featured in the first season of the Netflix series. With that being said, who is Tessaya de Vries? Tessaya de Vries is one of the oldest sorceresses alive. To indicate how old she is, 100 years before the books, she was among the mages that were summoned by King Goidemar of Temeria to investigate which one of three children was Falca's and not his own. The wife of King Goidemar was Rhiannon, the daughter of Lara Doran and Creganon of Lot. Rhiannon's children had the Elder Blood. Two of these children eventually became Ciri's great-great-great-grandmother and grandfather. But they didn't marry each other, they just connected later down the line. But that's not the most important connection Tessaya has to the three main characters. She, in fact, is very close to Yennefer. You could even go as far as to say they had a kind of mother-daughter relationship. To understand how this all started, we have to go back to the time when Yennefer was studying at Arethusa. Yennefer was deformed as a child. She was supposed to be a hunchback, the show however seems to have also given her a jaw deformation. Yennefer wasn't happy with how she looked, how she felt, and at some point decided that her life wasn't worth it anymore. She tried to take her own life, she cut deep. However, by some miracle, she survived. Once she awakened, Tessaya de Vries, who was that time the rector of Arethusa, sat right next to her bed. Most of the time, when sorceresses tried to take their own life, it was just for attention. However, Tessaya had noticed that Yennefer actually wanted to end it all, and therefore she came to help. She saw a lot of potential in Yennefer, and wanted to help her develop her full potential. I shall take care of you, girl, because I believe it's worth it. And it will require a good deal of work. Oh, but it will. I will not only have to straighten your spine and shoulders, but also heal your hands. When you slit your wrist, you severed the tendons, and the sorceress's hands are most important instruments. I shall take care of you. And now, we are alone here. Without witnesses, no one will see you, and I shan't tell anyone. Weep, girl. Have a good cry. Weep your heart out for the last time. For later, you won't be able to. There isn't a more hideous sight than a sorceress weeping. From this point onward, they became close. They knew a lot about each other. Yennefer gained a lot of respect for the Archmistress of Magic. Tessaya was most likely one of the most powerful female magic users on the continent. She was known throughout the continent and was responsible for the education of dozens of sorceresses. Among her students were Yennefer of Vengerberg, Sabrina Glevesig, and Philippa Aalhart. Tessaya had considered Philippa to be the best student she'd ever had. She'd always been proud of her. However, even though Philippa performs better, she still had more of a liking towards Yennefer. Tessaya strived for order. Everything had to be just right, to be perfect. She's also perhaps the only character in the books that seems to have a kind of OCD. Everything always had to be perfectly symmetrical. Throughout the books, she's constantly adjusting her sleeves, moving small objects around tables, so that everything looks neat and in balance. Going back to her relationship with Yennefer, there might have been one source of conflict between them: getting pregnant. Yennefer has always wanted a child. Tessaya, however, was an advocate for sterilization among sorceresses. In the book she had written called The Poisoned Source, she states the following: No one is born a wizard. We still know too little about genetics and the mechanisms of heredity. We sacrifice too little time and means on research. Unfortunately, we constantly try to pass on inherited magical abilities in, so to say, a natural way. Results of these pseudo-experiments can be seen all too often in town gutters and within temple walls. We see too many of them, and too frequently come across morons and women in a catatonic state, dribbling seers who soil themselves, seeresses, village oracles, and miracle workers. Cretins whose minds are degenerate due to the inherited, uncontrolled force. These morons and cretins can also have offspring, can pass on the abilities and this degenerate further. Is anyone in a position to foresee or describe how the last link in such a chain would look? Most of us wizards lose the ability to procreate due to somatic changes and dysfunction of the preparatorial gland. Some wizards, usually women, attuned to the magic while still maintaining the efficiency of the gonads. They can conceive and give birth and have the audacity to consider this happiness and a blessing. But I repeat, no one is born a wizard, and no one should be born one. Conscious of the gravity what I write, I answer the question posed at the Congress in Sedaris. I ask most empathetically, each of us must decide what she wants to be, a wizard or a mother. I demand all apprentices to be sterilized, without exception. It's never outright confirmed whether this was responsible for Yennefer's being sterile, or whether it's due to her magical... due to the first part, which could also result in sterilization. But if she was responsible for Yennefer not being able to get children, not being able to get pregnant, that would possibly add a conflict in their relationship. So I'm curious what the show is going to take of this. Before I go into the spoiler part, let's talk about the status within the magic user society. Tessaya is very, very talented, and could be considered among the very best sorceresses on the continent. Her prowess has earned her a high place within the governing factions of sorcerers. She is one of the five members of the chapter of the Gift and the Art, most often referred to as the Chapter. This is the highest any sorcerer or sorceress could achieve in the Northern Realms. Other notable members of the chapter are Vilgefortz of Roggeveen, Hen Gedemeth, Artaud Terranova, and Francesca Vindaber. They had the most to say when it comes to the mages in the North, what they should do and what they weren't allowed to do. There's also lower governing bodies, for example there's one where Philippa and Yennefer sit in, but this one is higher. From here on, I'll go into the spoiler parts. This is a spoiler warning for the book The Blood of Elves. After I'm done with this part, I'll go into the spoiler warning for the book after that. One thing to keep in mind, because Blood of Elves will most likely be the second season of The Witcher TV show on Netflix, it could possibly mean that I'm going to talk about spoilers for season 2 of The Witcher Netflix series. This is the final warning. Spoilers for Blood of Elves. Tessaya's role in Blood of Elves is not that major. However, it's her first actual appearance in the books. During the years following the Battle of Sodden Hill, which ended the First Northern War and resulted in the death of 13 mages from the north, Vilgefortz had taken more and more power within the chapter. He used everyone as pawns in his game, including Tessaya. Which leads to when she actually appears. She and Terranova were invited by Vilgefortz to discuss some matters. Tessaya already knew that something was up. However, she still went. During the time she spent at Vilgefortz's home, she noticed that she was hiding something using illusions. Most magic users wouldn't be able to discover what was hidden behind this illusion, However, Desaya, with all her years of practice, could. And even without anyone noticing that she could see right through this illusion barrier. Hidden on the table, behind the illusions, were all manner of magical experiments and apparatus. Most mages would have to look closely at it to see what its purpose was. However, not Desaya. Decades, or even centuries, she spent teaching others, led her to being able to decipher their use in a single glance. But that wasn't all that was hidden. There were books. One about the Elder Blood, and another about Ithlin's prophecy. Desaya knew what this meant. Vilgefortz was trying to find Yennefer and Ciri. However, Yennefer's attire and accessoire made it impossible to track her down. While she was looking around her and trying to figure out what Vilgefortz was up to, we get some more signs about her special behavior, her desire for order. Desaya de Vries ate slowly, devoting more attention to arranging her plates, cutlery, and napkins symmetrically, although in her opinion they still lay irregularly, and her predilection for order and her aesthetic sensibility than to the fair. Vilgefortz was talking to both Desaya and Terranova. However, this part feels more like it's mainly about Desaya and Vilgefortz. Desaya knew Vilgefortz was using the chapter as pawns in his game. Desaya knew that she was being played. She, however, wanted to know what Vilgefortz wanted of her, and what she was being used to, for what purpose. Vilgefortz asked them to support the idea of calling together all the mages in the north to discuss what the next course of action should be, as the rulers of the north seemed to want to provoke a war with Nilfgaard, and Nilfgaard was ready as well. Desaya agreed to this convention. Not only because Vilgefortz wanted it, but also because it could actually come in useful to get everyone together and to talk about the current state of the mage society. This meeting or convention takes place in Time of Contempt. Now I'll move over to Time of Contempt, which will most likely be either the later part of Season 2, or it will be in Season 3 of the Witcher Netflix series if it gets to Season 3. Spoiler warning, Time of Contempt. This is the book where Desaya is most prominently featured, and for good reason. As Arethusa was made ready for the gathering of the mages, some students managed to slip out into Gorse Valon. Desaya and Margarita were looking for these students. They, however, managed to stumble into Ciri, who was in Gorse Valon, as Yennefer was on her way to the gathering. While Margarita wasn't sure if Ciri was a student at Arethusa or not, Desaya was sure of herself and she thought that Ciri was a student, due to that she was wearing a magical amulet. This resulted in Desaya paralyzing Ciri to question her. This, however, was all sorted out eventually and ended up with Yennefer, Margarita and Desaya bathing without wearing clothes. Following these events, sometime later, the banquet on the Senate started. Everything seemed to go well. Desaya talked with Yennefer about Ciri, everyone seemed okay. However, this all changed. Fighting had started, and Philippa and associates had captured several mages who were conspiring with Nilfgaard, Vilgefortz included. Desaya was also in change, however she was neutral in the conflict. Desaya knew that Vilgefortz wasn't innocent, however she wanted to have proof of the accusations Philippa made against him and his allies, as we can see in the following part from Time of Contempt. It's a heavy accusation, therefore the evidence will have to be just as weighty. But before you throw this evidence on her skills, Philippa Owlheart, be aware of my position. Evidence can be fabricated, actions and her motives can be interpreted. However, the present facts do not change anything. You broke the unity and solidarity of the Brotherhood. Philippa Owlheart, you chained up members of the chapter like thieves. Do not dare to propose a place in the new chapter. your band of crook plotters to plan, to create and sell to the kings. Between us, there is blood and death. Hengedameth is dead, the blood of Lydia van Bredevoort. With contempt, you have spilled this blood. You were my best student, Philippa Eilhart. I've always been proud of you. But now, I have not only contempt for you. Right after this, on Tessiah's order, Yennefer brought Ciri into the room, while Ciri was in a trance. She talked about all kinds of events that had happened during the day, including the death of King Vesemir of Verdania, and what seemed like the North starting a war against Nilfgaard. "Do not listen," Philippa cries. "Do not listen to this medium. It is a tool, a mindless tool. Who do you serve, Yennefer? Who commanded you to bring this monster here?" "I did," Tessiah the Vries said. Right after this, Tessiah removed the magical blockades from Garstang and freed Vilgefortz and his allies, believing that Philippa was the traitor. She turned out to be wrong. Spells started flying. Everyone was fighting. Tessiah had realized the mistake she had made. All around her were dead mages. She realized that she had to do something and jumped to the defense of Philippa's side to protect them from Vilgefortz. Her defense was strong enough to hold him off. However, he started mocking and ridiculing her for the mistakes she made in freeing him. As the fighting continued, both Scoia'tael and Verdanians emerged and were fighting and running all around the island. Ciri had teleported away to the Koroth Desert, and Geralt had been injured by Vilgefortz in combat. Triss tried to help Geralt and wanted to get him out of there, to somewhere safe where he could heal. Then suddenly, Tessiah came. At the top of the stairs stood Tessiah de Vries. Her hair was in disarray, her face was covered with dust. She raised both her hands, her fingers burned. She shouted an incantation, and the fire dancing on her fingers burst forth in a fireball, which roared down the stairs, the flames crackling and blinding. The Witcher heard the rumble from below, the walls crumbling, the shrill screams of the burnt. "Tessiah, no!" Triss yelled desperately. "Don't do it! Do not enter here," said the great teacher without looking back. "This is Garstang, on the island of Thanet. Nobody invited the royal servants carrying out the orders of the short-sighted rulers. You're killing them!" "Be silent, Triss Marigold." The coup against the unity of the Brotherhood was not successful. This island is governed by the Chapter. So to keep the kings away from the affairs of the Chapter, it is our conflict, and we'll solve it ourselves. We will resolve our issues and put an end to this idiotic war. Because we, the sorcerers, are responsible for the fate of the world." Other fireballs shot from her hands. The echo of explosions was repeatedly heard between the columns and walls. "Get out," she screamed again. "Do not enter here. Get out." Tessiah was fighting for the Brotherhood, the last one around that still tried to defend it, when all others, either joined up with one of the two sides, had fled or died. Tessiah was the last defense of the Brotherhood, and she was giving it all to take back what she saw as her home. She told Triss to leave. However, Triss didn't want to leave without Geralt, and begged Tessiah to help them. She did. A short time after all that had happened on Thanet, Tessiah sat down in a chair behind a desk, while she could hear the sounds of soldiers running around. She was writing down a letter, signing it with a nickname she hadn't used since she started at Arethusa: Skylark. Tessiah fixed her clothing, adjusting it when need be, and sat back down into her chair. A maid had recently cleaned and moved some objects out of place. She moved all the objects on the desk so that everything was where it was supposed to be. Everything was in perfect balance and order. The sun slowly went under as she took a scalpel from a drawer and slit both of her wrists. The Saya had ended her own life, and with her died the Brotherhood. You might wonder why she killed herself. The most probable reason is that she felt as though she had failed everyone. Her actions on Thanet led to the deaths of many mages, and all because she lifted the barrier. She couldn't live with feeling of guilt and ended her own life. Following her death, she is talked about a few times later on in the books. One of the most important moments is when Yennefer was brought for the first time to the Lodge. This will contain from now on some spoilers for the rest of the books. You have been warned. One of the most important moments when the Saya is mentioned again after her death is when Yennefer was first brought in to the Lodge. I have nothing more to say. The black-haired sorceress pursed her lips. I repeat, it was the Saya de Vries who ordered me to bring Ciri to Garstown. It's easier to blame everything on the dead, Sabrina Glapsic snorted. But Philippa silenced her sudden gesture. I did not want to interfere in what was happening in Aretusa, said Yennefer, pale and clearly upset. I wanted to take Ciri and escape from Thanet. But the Saya convinced me that the appearance of the girl at Garstown would be a shock to many, and her brought in before them in a trance-speaking prophecy would avert the conflict. I cast no blame on her because I thought the same. The two of us made a mistake, but mine was bigger. After the Brotherhood fell apart, the Lodge was founded, existing out of exclusively female sorceresses. It is speculated by members of the Lodge that if the Saya wouldn't have killed herself, she would have joined the Lodge to help them protect magic in the world. However, one thing that made the Saya even more special was that she felt as though she was accountable for the ordinary people. She cared about them and didn't see them as low and worthless compared to some other magic users. She just really seemed to dislike the politics of the rulers. The Saya was one of the most well-respected magic users on the continent. However, even with all her experience and all her power, she couldn't save the Brotherhood, and instead led towards a definitive destruction, as well as the deaths of many sorcerers and sorceresses. The Saya's story feels tragic. She stood for order and reason. She helped Yennefer and was like a mother to her. And in the end, her actions caused the death of many. And she felt so guilty for that, that she didn't want to live like that anymore. As you might notice by the name, the Saya de Vries is a Dutch surname, which mostly refers to a person coming from a specific region in the Netherlands. Also, something quite notable, the Witcher Netflix series, the woman who plays the Saya, is the same woman who did Anna Henrietta's voice in The Witcher 3 Blood and Wine. She was connected to both the games and the Netflix series. But that was it for the Saya de Vries. This has been probably my longest video till date. Till next video. Bye.